Professor Dave here. Let's talk about beta-dicarbonyl compounds.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So when we learned about Claisen condensation, we saw that we could take an ester substrate and produce a beta-dicarbonyl compound. So let's look at some things that we can do with beta-dicarbonyl compounds. Here is one of them, and we can imagine that we produce this from a Claisen condensation, say from a two-carbon ester. This two-carbon ester right here could have attacked this one. This would have been the new bond. And then we would have this beta-dicarbonyl compound. So consider this an extension of Claisen. What can we do with this now? Now, one key feature that we did mention before that we want to understand about beta-dicarbonyl compounds is that suddenly, because of the proximity of these carbonyls, the acidity of the alpha protons is dramatically altered. They become much, much more acidic. Whereas an alpha proton in an aldehyde or ketone is usually pKa around 19, somewhere in that vicinity, for a beta-dicarbonyl compound, we're jumping down to a pKa of around 9 or 10. So that's around 10 orders of magnitude. That's a billion or 10 billion times more acidic. So you can see it's a very dramatic effect when we have a beta-dicarbonyl compound. So we can do some acid-base chemistry. Let's take our alkoxide, whatever it is, and let's do an acid-base reaction. Let's just leave that negative charge on the carbon right there. So we know we can push that up there, but let's show this intermediate, and the composite resonance structure shows us why this pKa has jumped down to such a low value. Because the thing is this, we could draw a number of resonance structures where we push this anion up into that carbonyl, or we could push it up into that carbonyl. In any case, we know that none of the individual resonance structures are real. It is the composite resonance structure that truly exists. So here is the composite resonance structure with pi electron density distributed all along this portion of the molecule. The more that you delocalize a formal charge, the more you are stabilizing it. This is more delocalization than a regular enolate, so it is more stable. Hence, the relationship between acidity and stability of the conjugate base, that means these were much more acidic if they are producing something that is much more stable. So that is how we're getting to here. And now, one thing that we can do from here is we can alkylate at this position. So we can do simple SN2, where we are just having this act as a carbon nucleophile on some alkyl halide. So why don't we have this attack ethyl bromide? So let's attack that right there. Kick off that bromine. So we have attached an ethyl group at this position right here. That was just a regular SN2 reaction. And so, but the thing is, we're going to use excess. There's a lot more base in solution, and there is no reason that this, right, there were two acidic protons to begin with, and we got one of them to produce the anion to do one SN2. But there's more there. There's another proton, and there's more base in solution. So why don't we do it again? We can absolutely do this twice. It's certainly going to be at the same location. This is the acidic location, right? We're not going to do anything over here. This has a much higher pKa. This is not acidic or as acidic. All of the chemistry is certainly going to happen at this position. So we're just going to do the same thing. We've got another anion, and why don't we do another SN2 here? Let's just go and attack there, kick that off. And so we have attached two ethyl groups at this alpha position, the position that is alpha to both of those carbonyls. So this is one thing we could do. We could alkylate. And then another interesting thing we could do to follow that is hydrolysis and then decarboxylation. So what that means is we can hydrolyze here, hydrolysis meaning the hydroxyl group is going to replace the alkoxy group. And so we don't have to show the whole thing. We've seen this before. Right, I mean, I suppose what we can do, rather than draw the intermediate, we can say that goes up and then comes back down. Right, we could draw that discrete intermediate where we have O minus, but then that's just going to come right down, kick off OR, and now we have OH instead of OR. So that was hydrolysis, right? We have hydrolyzed that ester. Now we have OH right there. And now we are actually primed for something that's very interesting. Now, we want to point out that the only reason this is possible is because we have a beta-dicarbonyl situation. We have a carboxylic acid that is beta to a ketone, and we need that relationship. If this carbonyl was not here, this would not be possible, and here's why. Let's go ahead and deprotonate that carboxylic acid. So let's take this, let's get that proton. Now we're going to take the electrons in this sigma bond. We're going to go and we're going to make this pi bond here, but instead of interfering with this carbonyl and then just pushing that up there, we can actually sever this carbon-carbon sigma bond. We can actually break this bond and just push this over here. Okay? So we are taking this proton and then this snaps shut and CO2 leaves. Right? So we're going to get this and we're going to get, where can I draw this? Plus CO2, right? We are losing CO2. So let's say there's that, and that's all this, right? We are losing a molecule. Actually, I should say it's all this, right? Not, we're grabbing that hydrogen, but then this snaps shut, and we lose CO2. So this is called decarboxylation. Long word there. So this is the decarboxylation step. This sigma bond is going to flip over here, and we're going to make that enolate, and then we can just do some acidic workup, and we're going to get our ketone product. Okay, so these are some things that we can do with beta-dicarbonyl compounds, which once again are the products of Claisen condensation. So we could have done all of this chemistry. Look, we could have started with a two-carbon ester like this, just this two-carbon ester, and we could have done all of this chemistry to get this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7-carbon ketone. So it's actually quite powerful synthetically. We've gone from a 2-carbon compound to a 7-carbon compound, and all we've done is simple enolate chemistry and SN2. So it's not very complicated. We made the enolate and then did an SN2 to attach an ethyl group right there, and then we did it again, right? We got the enolate and we attached another ethyl group right there. And then following that, we did hydrolysis. Right, the OH replaced the OR, so we've got the OH there, and then we did decarboxylation. So just to make sure that we understand what's going on here, these five carbons, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's these, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we've just redrawn it, right? Don't get confused about the fact that these two carbons are here. It looks like those positions. It's these five carbons. It's just that this carbon went from sp3 to sp2. That flattened out. This portion of the molecule is planar. So these two ethyl groups here are the two ethyl groups that came from these ethyl bromides. And that is our decarboxylation. Heat is going to drive that. It is entropically favorable for one molecule to become two. More disorder, entropically favorable, and higher heat favors entropically favorable processes. And so that is our decarboxylation. That is going to protonate aqueous acidic workup, and we'll get our ketone product. So those are some things we can do with beta-dicarbonyl compounds. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.